Live from the Four Aces Studios, Four Aces Presents brings to you West Coast Bias.
And just giving y'all a heads up, letting y'all know this is an NSFW show. So if you are sitting at work listening in, be sure to turn us off now because you never know what you might hear. Mr. Suave, what is up?
What's up, man?
We are back live here from 4Aces Studios with this week's edition of West Coast Bias. Suave, I figured, you know, all the stuff that's been going on in sports over the past couple weeks, you know, last year we did a quick little, March Madness episode there. And I know you paid attention to the tournament as it was going on. You may not have watched every single game. You know, heck, I didn't even get a chance to watch every single game this year. But let's tackle some real quick overall thoughts on this year's tournament as we go into tomorrow's title game between Villanova and North Carolina.
Well, North Carolina was able to play a good game and got the victory. That Villanova over Oklahoma was a mind-blowing show-out. I mean, that Villanova team, I mean, a 44-point lead in the Final Four. I never thought I'd ever see something like that. Even if a team was playing its best game, that like Villanova was, and Oklahoma was playing its worst game, I never thought I'd see a team get beaten like that, ever. I mean, we've seen there's some 10, 20-point blowouts. I mean, you see the kind of thing sometimes versus the wins in 16 at the very beginning of the tournament, you know, or maybe in the women's game, you see a lot of these types of scores. But in the men's game, especially when the talent level increases as it gets deeper into the tournament, you don't see these type of flashes. They really put one on Oklahoma. And it's so bad. I mean, usually making it to the tournament can boost, you know, your recruiting power and your capture. But the whipping that Oklahoma took, I'm not sure they're going to be able to recover. I mean, to get blown out on the national stage in that fashion, I don't know. I mean, the kids that were looking at Oklahoma, even the homegrowns might be like, well, maybe Oklahoma State, maybe they didn't miss the tournament. Villanova, you know, you got to give them a lot of credit. They really took Oklahoma to the woodshed, and they went to town for two halves.
You know, yeah, and you know, that was one of the things that I paid attention to because I'll be honest, I was one of those people that when I had Oklahoma making it that far, I had definitely had them beating a team like Villanova. Hell, I had them upsetting a one seed at one point. But wow, Buddy Hield and them just did not show up. It shows how even some of the best players in the game can have bad nights. You know what I'm saying? Like just have an off night and have bad things happen. And that seemed to be the theme of this year's tournament, was starting with, you know, the biggest upset of the entire tournament, which to me was Michigan State losing to Middle Tennessee State, a 15 seed. That was like, holy, what the hell happened here? You know, when you think about it, you talk about cachet. Like, of course, Michigan State's always going to have their cachet as long as they have what's his name? It's not D'Antonio. That's the God, I can't believe I can't remember his name. Tom Izzo. You know, as long as they got Izzo, they got the cachet to draw in, you know, some big name recruits. But it's got to hurt a little bit. You know, think about what's going on there in Michigan State when they're losing to Middle Tennessee State. So, but not, that's enough tournament to talk. But you want to talk about teams taking upset losses. our dubs, man. Well, what happened? Like, I found myself stunned on Friday night watching our team just – I guess at some point the shots that always fall for you have to take a break or stop falling for you for a little bit. But, wow, because they really did have a shot to tie it up at the end. I thought for sure Steph was about to come back and knock down that three and at least tie it up and give us overtime and go from there, you know. But I guess it was not meant to be.
There's something that's been happening to this Warriors team, and I know they only have 6 games left before the playoffs, but they really need to try and work on it. Some people say the weight of the different streets and the weight of trying to get to 73 is weighing them down. But I think what's really weighing them down is a game-to-game lack of focus and, turnovers. Just uncharacteristic, and I never thought I'd say that 3 years ago, uncharacteristic turnovers. And, when that leads, I believe it was like 22 or 27 points for the Celtics on turnovers, any team in the league, a lot of people, poke fun of the lower-ranked teams. Like, I saw somebody on Facebook say the UConn women team might be able to beat the 76ers, and even the 76ers will crush UConn. No matter how good they are, they would get whooped and probably spanked bad. But even the lower end, I want to give the Celtics credit. But they're actually having a great season. I believe they're fourth in the East or something like that. They're having a real good year. They're on their way up. They've got a lot of great young talent. And they are the number 3 rated defensive team behind Golden State and San Antonio, who was the first spot. So they're a good defensive team, and when you're sloppy against any team, and this goes all the way back to the Lakers game, when you're sloppy against a team and your shot isn't falling, and what you need to do is rely on execution, if those things falter, any team in the league can beat you. And that's how the Warriors have lost. And the only silver lining would be it's only happened 8 times this year, which is really something. 8 times out of what we had, over 70 plus games, we're 76 games. So it's only happened 8 times that the Warriors have done this, and we can rule out 2 of those losses, because of injury. I really hate to say that, but let's be honest, Steph missed the game, and I believe Draymond missed the game early on when they lost. So, you got to take your hat to the Celtics, and hopefully this type of game is what refocuses this team to what it needs to do. You limit turnovers, you execute, and 9 times out of 10, you will win the basketball game. That's the key to success for the Spurs. It has been the entire tenure of Duncan and Pop's run of the San Antonio franchise. And for the last year and a half, or a year or 2 years now, that's been the Duffs calling. So it's time for them to get back to that. They've been a bit sloppy. Also, in a short amount of time, gotten to the point where more often than not, they play to the level of their competition versus playing their brand of basketball. And it happens, and they've been doing it and winning. And that shows how great of a team they are. Because even though they've been playing to the level of the competition, committing stupid turnovers, being lazy passes, not executing the floor of offense, every once in a while not making the extra pass, they've been able to win. Sometimes coming from behind to win, and sometimes erasing a deficit to come back to win, and sometimes winning a tie game. You take your hat to the Celtics, and I honestly, the Warriors are still on pace to break the record, the season record of wins that the Bulls hold, and I want to thank the Celtics. Because even if the Warriors don't get that mark and take a couple of speed bumps along the way to start the playoffs, it's these losses that help refocus and re-energize the team. And when you look at the Warriors, the one thing you can say is that every time they've taken a loss, they've gone on a run. I think every time, except I think one time early in the season, they lost a game, won the game, then lost another game, and then went on the long streak. So more often than not, a loss perpetuates a long winning streak by this Warriors team. So they ran off six straight wins from the time they lost to the Spurs until the time they lost to the Celtics. So they basically over the last eight games were 8-2. There's not a team or 6-2, excuse me. There's not a team in the league that wouldn't take an 8-2 run over any stretch of eight games in their entire season. But I'm sure every team on the bottom sure would, and damn near every team on top sure would. You know, so there's a couple things for the Warriors to work on. I still love their chances to repeat a champion. They're 68-8. So there's, you know, eight games you can say, you know, like I said, two for injury, but the other six, you got to just hit your cap and say, hey, you're fully manned and still going to beat. And then on top of that, were the Warriors fully manned? No. You know, against the Spurs, they were missing Iguodala, Ezeli. Against the Celtics, I don't believe Iggy or Ezeli played. And their key calls, and people say, hey, well, they're not starters. Let's be honest. Iggy's the sixth man of the year candidate, and Ezeli is one of the best upcoming centers in the league and a person that's expected to take Bogut's spot in the next year or two. And that tells you the quality that he is. So for them missing two of the better bench players, you know, it shows that, you know, when you're missing key pieces, you have to execute even at an even higher level. But at the same time, this didn't come against Boston, it didn't come against the bottom feeder. The Celtics have legitimately become a very good team. They're not great.
They're a playoff team in the East.
And, yeah, absolutely. So like I said, they're good. They're not great. Yeah, maybe another year or two, they'll be one of the great teams. But let's be honest, when you're talking Eastern Conference, you know, a lot of people were saying, oh, well, the East has better records than the West. Well, yeah, but let's be honest, there's four teams in the West that can win the title and only consider one in the East that can win the title. You know, so when you look at there hasn't really been a power shift. It's just been a records shift. You know, the records in the Western teams got it close to 500 at the bottom. But, and on the East, you got a lot of teams winning records, which hasn't happened in a long time. But still, the balance of power is still on the West versus the East. But you've got to give credit to the rising Celtics because I thought it would take a longer time for them to jump back up and become a good team again. And I go back to when Doc Rivers copped out and basically forced his way to Los Angeles to become the Clippers head coach because he didn't want to go, quote-unquote, through a rebuild, which I thought was kind of bogus.
Yeah.
So I'm really happy that Danny Ainge's vision has come through, and Brad Stevens is an excellent basketball coach. I mean, they're not too often you see the guys come from college and really, really take the team and build it and push it and get it to where it's good. Usually, you know, the college guy comes in, and unless the team's already, you know, built, a bottom feeder stays a bottom feeder. It's rare for a guy to come in and really change the team coming from college. But Brad Stevens, to give him credit, he's got the Celtics playing football, and as the number three defensive team in the league, you just gotta, I mean, he should probably get some coach of the year votes if they weren't all going to go to Popovich and Steve Kerr.
I hate to say this, you know, one of my major points in the coaching thing is that Luke Walton, like you said, he should be getting a lot of credit. I liked what his father had to say, Bill Walton, about sticking with the Warriors and staying with this program for a couple more years because at this point there's no place he can go and that's going to provide him with as special of an experience as what he's experiencing in Golden State right now. And that meant a lot to me because it's one of the old school guys recognizing and giving acknowledgement to exactly what's going on in Golden State without trying to rip down Golden State in the process. You know, or try to say how their generation was better.
It's right? Double-edged. I think that was also double-edged. I heard the same interview by his dad, Bill Walton. I just want to say I understand where he's coming from, but at the same time, when you look at the landscape of the NBA, of the teams that will possibly have a job opening, there's only really one attractive job out there that could come open, and that's really the miss. Sort of symbols because of all the young talent they have, I can kind of envision them being the next Boston Celtics, the next team to kind of raise itself up because of the talent that they have. But other than that job, I don't think we should leave for any of them. I mean, the Minnesota job is the only one where I would consider that. I would hope that he would consider to leave. But other than that, there's nothing out there with a chance to do what this team has been doing and be a part of it. I I mean, we've seen it. You know, as the Warriors have risen up, the top candidate, the top head coach has almost always left the year after. You know, you had Malone leave Sacramento, and then Sacramento continued to stink up the joint. You had last year, what's his name? Oh, man, I can't believe
I can't remember.
Name.
Gentry. Alvin Gentry.
The coach went to the Pelicans.
Alvin Gentry.
Yeah, Alvin Gentry, both the Pelicans, because the Pelicans look like they're going to be upcomers. The injury just totally destroyed the team, and now they're looking at a lottery pick versus being in playoffs. So, you know, the grass isn't always greener when you go to the league. You know, so I'm not saying they're doom and gloom if he goes, if he would happen to go to Minnesota if that job opens up. But Minnesota is the only job I would potentially leave my situation as a Warriors assistant coach for if I were in Luke Walton's shoes. And even then, it's really 50-50. I mean, he made a lot of money as a player. He's won some championships. So the allure, you know, and he's continued to win because he was there last year for their title. But, you know, I hope that he stays because I like him as a player. He's a hustle player. He's really taken the opportunity to learn from some of the greats like Bill Jackson and whatnot. So I really like Kerr, and I think I would like Kerr. But Walton, I mean, I hate to see him leave. But if he did, I would hope it was for Minnesota, because if it's not Minnesota, I hope he wouldn't take any other job.
Well, I'll say it like this. I can say this. Despite the turmoil in the locker room, the Lakers' job, talent-wise and on paper, doesn't look like that bad of a job. And Brian Shaw may be on his way out, unfortunately. But I say stick with Golden State for this. Steve Kerr, I know he just started coaching, but y'all act like Steve Kerr going to be coaching well into his 70s. You know, and he very well might, but...
Oh, that's true. That's true. That's another thing. Saying? Absolutely.
He can wait his and bide his time and take over this Golden State team.
Yeah, with the injury, the spinal fluid leakage, and the constant migraine headaches, and the, you know, just this season missing 30-plus games of the season, start of the season, you know, his future has to be, quote-unquote, in doubt in a sense. And if I were the Warriors, I would catch up Luke Walton over the next 3 years just to see, you know, make him the top paid assistant in the league. Make him, you know, I don't know what the lowest salary is for the worst coach in the NBA or the lowest paid coach, excuse me, in the NBA is, but I would match that salary to keep Luke Walton where he is for the next 3, maybe 4 seasons, just to make sure that Kerr's able to get past this you know, injury, bug, history, fluky kind of thing he's going through.
Man.
You know, because I totally feel you. I mean, it would be terrible if Luke, I mean, I think the team's good enough to win with almost anybody, to be honest, but at the same time, if Luke were to go to leave, let's say, 2 to 10 simple job, and then next year, Kerr, you know, says, hey, my body just can't do it, I have to retire, where does that exactly leave us? You know, I mean, I'd be real worried. But at the same time, I still feel that, you know, I'm one of those guys that feel like, you know, maybe the team wouldn't be as great, but I think Tom Jackson could have gotten this team to the height it is now because of the greatness of the players.
Well,
I feel that, you know, they're all coaches that can come in and be good still, but why would you want to take the chance?
True. Well, and that's the alternate point, and here's an alternate point that I was kind of working my way towards was this. The once-in-a-lifetime experience thing is the one thing for me. Like, yeah, I would love to see them keep them just in case, you know, Steve Kerr ain't much longer for this game of head coaching. But you could also, to actually also offer you an option of how they could do that. They could do it like the Dallas Cowboys did with Jason Garrett. Pay him as a head coach in waiting. You know, like, look, dude, yeah, like, you're going to make pretty much like $2 million off of what Steve Kerr makes. But, you know, we're gonna try to hold on to you. But as far as Luke, like, just realizing that, like, winner, like I said, how many times in the history of the NBA have we had a team that went 67 and 15 one year and went and so far has won 68 games and may possibly win 70 plus before the year is over the very next year? You know what I'm saying? You don't see that very often.
I'll take it a step further. How many times did Phil Jackson go somewhere and take Tex Winters along with him? Tex Winters, for the most part, never took a head coaching job, but he was always at top assistance for the Phil Jackson team. So, Luke Walton could get that type of position and know that he would be the guy in waiting. Like you said, the perfect example was Jerry Jones. You know, he liked Garrett. He knew he wanted Garrett. He waited. He got rid of the coach, and the coach's contract went up. I forget what happened, but then he promoted the guy he knew he wanted to take over when that time came. And if I'm the Warriors, I'm thinking in the exact same mold of Jerry Jones in this instance.
And I can definitely see Lacob doing that. The last thing we'll talk about the Dubs is Lacob's comment about the fact that the Warriors are light years ahead of every other team in the NBA as far as where they're going and how they run their structure and how they build a winner that continues to be a winner. And I agree with his statement completely. You know, of course, our arch nemesis, Skip Bayless of First Take thought it was just him. You know, he brought his Spurs pom-poms out. You know, I don't know if you got to see that episode after the Lakeup interview broke, but he brought out his grand black pom-poms and was shaking them hard for the Spurs, as the Spurs are still the gold standard. They haven't gone anywhere. And you know what? I hate to say it. The Spurs were the gold standard for the past decade. But the minute they got knocked off by the Clippers and couldn't challenge the Warriors last year, I'm sorry, that was nail number one in the final nail in their coffin. If they get bounced by the Dubs this year in the conference finals, that'll be nail number two. Like, and then when the big three
retire. If they make the conference finals.
Exactly. And that's the one point that I've been pitching to people that not a lot of people understand it. They're thinking I'm just being a Warriors hater. I'm like, no, look at who the Spurs have lost to this year and tell me that they don't have a good chance of being bounced before they ever get to the conference finals. You know, not.
Yeah, I will say that I will say Aldridge and Leonard have really started to shine over the last handful of games and look a lot better. Aldridge, especially, I think Leonard's been pretty good all season. Probably even would be considered their best player all season. They're starting to run their form as a duo. I'm totally on board with you. The Spurs had been the gold standard, and Lacob is loving every minute of this. You know, he takes over the team, hired Mark Jackson, who I think was the perfect choice at the time. That guy instills defense, and he let go of Mark because there was a conflict between front office and Mark. Then you get lightning in a bottle, and you snake out the New York Knicks, Steve Kerr, and then, you know, you're the golden team of the NBA. So Lacob is fully within his rights to kind of sow his oats, as it were, and proclaim, you know, the Warriors as the best, because let's be honest, they are the defending champions, and that gives you the leeway to say something like that. Now, would I prefer he not really say it? Yeah, only in the sense of it really didn't need to be said, you know, but at the same time, I'm not mad at Lakers for answering the question and kind of, you know, puffing us up a little bit, you know, because I remember when Mark Jackson said things like, you know, Steph Curry and Klay Thompson are the best shooters in the history of the game, the best backcourt tandem in the history of the game, and people were laughing and saying things, and now people are actually debating it. So much so that you've got people like, you know, MJ, Scottie Pippen, Magic Johnson, Charles Barkley, saying that their teams, because, you know, even ex-Warrior team players are saying that their team could have beat the Warrior team. So, you know, you see what happens when you get to the mountaintop, and I can totally understand why they felt the need to fluff his feathers up a little bit and say that. But at the same time, there was some truth to what he said.
For sure, for sure. All right, guys, since it's just the two of us here, I'm going to go on ahead and jump a subject that I was going to save till towards the end of the show to the front of the show. And we're going to go on ahead and discuss this Colin Kaepernick to the Denver Broncos situation that seems to be going round and round. Before, they had nothing. The Denver Broncos says he wasn't worth more than a fourth round pick. And the Niners wanted a second round pick for him. Then the Niners and Broncos finally get compensation worked out, and it's up to Colin Kaepernick to have to restructure his contract, but he's still trying to get paid his full $11.9 million. So, and Denver says, all right, we'll meet you a little over halfway. We'll pay $7 million. Now, Cap's sitting over there going, okay, now the Niners can just pay the other $4.9 million, and the Niners are like, wait a minute. Why are we going to pay you to play for another team when we still want you here? Nah, we're good. We're not paying $4.9 million. Work it out without the $4.9 million, or else we ain't in it. And then Denver's like, but we ain't paying you over the $7 million, so sorry. Suave,
well, here's my thing. All three situations want something. The Broncos want what they hope for the starting quarterback. Kaepernick wants the money that he feels he has earned from the play that led to the contract. And the Niners want something in return for that player. So everybody wants something out of the situation.
Well,
now
it said that the compensation is good for the Niners. They just don't want to pay his extra salary. That the Niners are good taking the draft picks. That they just don't want to have to pay his salary. Which I'll let you continue, but I'll talk about it a little bit later. Which I think is a fair enough thing to say.
Oh, it's totally fair. The question is, you know, do they believe that Colin Kaepernick, I mean, right now they're in a lucky position in terms of salary cap with the way certain things have happened. They have a lot more salary cap room than they did just a year earlier. Plus the fact that they weren't able to sign any real great free agents outside of their own players or extend their own players' contracts, so they have a lot of money so they can afford to eat Colin Kaepernick's contract even if he ends up being just a backup for them. Me, if I was the Niners, I would just pay the $4.9 million to be done with Colin Kaepernick, get the draft pick that I want for him, and absorb the hit. I don't even know if it would be a hit on their salary cap, but it doesn't matter because they still have, you know, the most out of any team in the league to be able to spend. So they could eat the $4.9 for one season and have it not kill them for future dead money or anything like that. For the Broncos, I'm kind of conflicted. Because if I remember right, they offered Brock Osweiler a 3-year, $45 million contract, which means he would have made $15 million this upcoming season. But now they want Colin Kaepernick to come in and only pay him $7 million. So I kind of feel Colin in the sense that, you know, hey, I earned the contract that I signed. And while it has a whole bunch of loopholes that is good for whatever team gets me, I still want to get paid. You know, I'm not going to take a pay cut and give away money in a sport where my career could be, let's be honest. Unless Colin Kaepernick resurrects his career, this could be the last year that he makes this type of money. So I wouldn't want to give it up either. You know, the almost $12 million, $5 million, $4.9 or whatever it is, I wouldn't want to give that up either, considering that if you give it up, and then next year Denver drafts a quarterback or finds a quarterback they want better, or heck, Kaepernick doesn't play to his own standards and he gets cut, you know, because it's still going to be a team-friendly deal that allows Denver to cut him. So if I were Kaepernick, I would accept less either, just because of how the deal is structured. You know, if it were structured where he had more guaranteed on the back end, or maybe they can work out something like that, well, then, yeah, I would take the pay cut. But his contract isn't necessarily set up that way. You know, he takes the pay cut, then he gets cut next year in the offseason, and then he's out. Not only all the rest of the money on his contract, but $5 million he basically just gave away just for just to get traded. So I have to pay Nick on this one. You know, has he been sucking? Yeah, especially last year, he really kind of sucked. But he earned that money from the, you know, it's always how it is. You earn your contract from the year before you got the contract, and then you try and live up to the hype. Has he lived up to it? No,
okay.
But he still has earned that money. So
okay.
I'm down, you know, I'm kind of in Kaepernick's boat, but at the same time, I understand all the sides, but I am kind of, it's just kind of funny because you see this type of thing happen in baseball all the time. You want to get rid of a player, you get something in return, and then you pay some of that salary. You know, we've seen teams do it all the time, to where it's not even a big deal in baseball. It's like, oh, and they're paying, you know, this year's salary or this prorated part of the salary.
Oh, but hold on, okay. So here's my thing, and I'm gonna kind of play Niners organization here, okay. You went out over the past 3 years, okay, one whole year while you had your quarterback guru, your best friend in the world, your butt buddy, Jim Harbaugh. You had him for an entire year and went fucking 8-8 and regressed from your previous success of the year before. The next year, under coach Jim Tomsula, who was not necessarily the right coach, you regressed yet a fucking again. so bad that we ended up sitting your ass halfway through the season and going with Blaine Gabbert. And no matter how bad Blaine Gabbert played, we never went back to you. Okay? And you expect to get paid? You expect us to continue to pay you after? Now, mind you, after having this horrible year and a half of playing, we still went out in the offseason, fired Tom Sula, and found a head coach that has an offensive playbook that completely suits your skill set. Nobody else's, not Blaine Gabbert's skill set, not the imaginary third-string quarterback, not Carlos Hyde's skill set, not Anquan Boldin's, but Colin Kaepernick's. Then all of a sudden, you want out? You want to go someplace else? Okay, fine. You want to go someplace else. Go someplace else then. Because the bottom line is this. Don't expect us to pay you when we catered the situation to you for this upcoming season, to your eventual success and resurrection, possibly to the benefit of both us and you, because if you come back for this season as a San Francisco 49er, come out and have an outstanding season in Chip Kelly's offense, and say you want out next year, Niners can get something for you. They can get proper compensation for you. You can get to keep your contract and get paid, and you can resurrect your career. But instead, you want people to pay you for nothing. You have done nothing over the past two seasons of fucking football, and specifically did nothing but sit on the bench for half a season last year. And you want to get paid what you feel you deserve? What you deserve is to have your ass sat in the third string spot on the roster. That's what your ass deserves. Not 4.9 out of the Niners. I don't care if they had $150 million in cap space. You don't deserve 4.9 of it. If you want out of a situation that was specifically built for you to succeed, then you can take a pay cut to leave that situation, and don't expect us to pay you on your way out your door. And I can understand if that's what the Niners organization is basically saying to them. You have sucked for the better part of the past two seasons. It's not like the Super Bowl season was just last year. You have sucked for the better part of the past two seasons. Now, this is coming from a man who used to defend Colin Kaepernick, who used to defend Colin Kaepernick on a regular basis. You can go back to old archive episodes of West Coast Bias and find actual arguments that I had with the duel about Colin Kaepernick, defending Colin Kaepernick and his potential level. And he has let me down time after fucking time after fucking time. So I don't want to hear this bullshit about money he deserves. He doesn't deserve shit. He's lucky he didn't get released and then he'd have to take whatever Denver gave him. Because wouldn't nobody else be offering his ass $11 million? Shit, RG3 only got $7 million. Let's think about that. Same situation pretty much. RG3 only got $7 million. So it looks like asking price, if you want to thank somebody for why you're not getting paid, Colin Kaepernick, thank RG3, because he's the one that kind of set the bar with the contract that he signed for Cleveland at about $7.5 million a year. But needless to say, Cap is hopefully going to be a Denver Bronco, or he's going to be the backup quarterback for the San Francisco 49ers. One of the two. Either way, I'm a happy man, but we'll see. Guys, let's go ahead and take that first commercial break. We'll come back with a quick Suave's take, and then we're going to talk some baseball. Hit the bat, hit the ball, throw the pitch, baseball. We're going to talk some A's, we're going to talk some Giants, and we're going to have a little fun right here on West Coast Bias. We're missing you, Heather. We're missing you. Get back to us soon. All right, folks. And let me tell you a little bit about where 4 Aces stretches beyond just Spreaker.com and our radio shows here, the plethora of radio shows and different voices that you hear here. We also have our hands out there in the world of video blogs with the Ron Pact Unleashed, as well as Double K's Classroom blog, the West Coast Bias .blogspot.com is one of our first video blogs, as well as the Ron Pact Unleashed blog .blogspot.com, which is another one of our video blogs, as well as our fan pages, which are updated almost every other day to every day for the Ron Pact Unleashed, Planet of Coal, Double K's Classroom, 4 Aces Presents in general, and also Now Versus Then and Now Versus Then West. You can find Facebook fan pages for all your favorite 4 Aces shows, as well as you can find us on YouTube now, where you can see the first 3 episodes of the 4 Aces Presents web series, produced by one and only Saint, out there killing it, getting the killer interviews. So keep listening in. We get a couple of new episodes about every month to every other month. So it's a great watch. I've starred in a couple of the episodes. We have great bands and great artists, as well as great hosts from Crazy Chick Productions and Essie from Dirty Talk 101. So guys, keep checking us out. We're constantly expanding. And this world of 4 Aces Presents is constantly getting better. Peace. All right, y'all, it's that time of day again for Mr. Suave to give you his take on this situation with Mr. Suave's take. Take him away, Suave.
All right, people. Well, let's see. I'm just gonna, you know, talk about, you know, I brought it up during the Warriors piece about players saying that their team could have beaten the Warriors, this Warrior team. Well, I can't remember a time where you hear it so much than with the Warriors. And I think it goes to show all the kind of hatred that the Warriors are getting now that they're, you know, the best team in the NBA. You know, you didn't really hear this about the injury teams, that they could go back in time and beat any of the other teams. You didn't hear this about the Houston team that won 94-95. You didn't hear this from Charles Barkley about the Phoenix Suns team beating any other teams because he was losing to Jordan. You know, you didn't hear these things as much. If ever, you know, usually a fan or something would come up. But for the actual players to be saying this, including players that have played for the franchise, like a Steven Jackson, you know, it's crazy the amount of hatred that the Warriors are getting. Maybe it's because they're getting actual national attention and love for the first time in 40 years, outside of a couple of scare moments. Like, we believe team, I think, was hot on people's minds for the 16-4 run to end the season and taking down the number one seed, Dallas, before choking and losing to Utah. That was the last time I can remember people other than Warriors fans talking about the Warriors. But now that the Warriors are the best team in the NBA and defending champions, everybody's coming out. Everybody is coming out. I mean, you even got people, you know, liking what Steph Curry and Klay Thompson are doing as teammates, like Oscar Robertson. I mean, I didn't hear people saying this stuff about Magic, MJ, Bird. Hell, even I didn't hear this stuff about Ron James outside of maybe the last, you know, I think Dominique said something that wouldn't be King James. You know, there was kind of some, you know, I'd say maybe hatred there in the sense of how large LeBron James has been. But they never said his teams. They never talked about his teams. I had certainly never heard this about the Spurs team that won titles. You know, oh, well, we could have beat that Spurs team. I never heard it. It's all about this Warriors team. And maybe it's because the Warriors have been so bad for so long, outside of a few handful of years, or really like 3 or 4 seasons out of the last 20, you know, it's so strange. You know, and now you've got Scottie Pippen coming out and saying he built his Chicago team that won 17 games would sweep the Warriors. Well, I'm here to tell you, Scottie, your Bulls teams, regardless of any of the years you won titles, never swept anybody in the finals. You didn't even sweep the Sonics. And they only had 3 great players. They didn't even have a bench. They had Gary Payton, Sean Kemp, and Dett Letcher. That's it. And you didn't even sweep them. They even took a game from you. So for you to sit here and think that this Dubs team wouldn't give your team a run for its money is crazy, especially because this is the kicker where every time someone brings up the argument, if you play by the rules that they are today in the game, You could not defend like you could back in the day. You couldn't hand check like you could back in the day. And zone defenses would limit a lot of the offensive firepower of the Chicago Bulls. Now, Jordan will still probably get his because he is a great elite player. There's no doubt about that. But what about everybody else that contributed on those teams? The John Pattons, the Steve Kerrs, the Jeff Bushers, the three-headed monster with Cartwright and Luke Longley at center. I mean, even Horace Grant was there, but even though he's, you know, one of the key pieces that missed it, you know, that 72-win season because he went to Orlando. So, I mean, I think everybody that's played the game needs to take a chill pill, calm the fuck down, and realize that their team has their moment. They were the big dogs at some point in time. Hell, Oscar Robinson, you were the big dog. Only guy to ever average a triple-double. Your place in history is set, and there's no reason to dog out the new kids on the block and to deride their what they're doing, you know. So, I mean, people really need to come hell down. You know, Steven Jackson, bro, you lost to fucking Utah. Yeah, you were one of the first teams in the best of seven to beat as an 18 and a one seed. Yeah, I give you that. And I loved you for it. But for you to sit here and think a team that couldn't get out the second round versus a Utah team that really only had Deron Williams could beat this Warrior incarnation, bro, just sit down and be quiet. I know you might want to hear yourself on TV, get some run, people will talk about you, but your time is done. Nobody wanted you on an NBA roster, which is why you had to retire. Your time is over. No way in hell that the Weebly team beats this Warrior team. And I'm a Warriors fan. I watched all of it. There's no way. There's a couple of matchups that might have leaned your way, but lean is the proverbial word here because this team is better in the starting five and deeper on the bench than the Weebly team could hope to dream to be. If the Weebly team were as good as this Warrior team, you wouldn't have lost to the fucking Utah Jazz. Now, moving on to Scotty. Bro. Sweep us. Your Bulls team would sweep us even though you never swept anybody in the finals. For real, dude. You need to just calm the hell down, enjoy the six rings you got with MJ, and your place in history. Just the top 50 NBA players of all time. There's no reason to even, you know, answer the question when it's asked to you because I'm sure that's how it came. You know, and you don't want to back down. I'm sure you don't want to give any credit because if that were the case, you wouldn't have said sweep. And most of you would have said everyone would have won in six or seven. But no, you just flat out said sweep. So it's obvious that you have a hatred for the Warriors. They were never good during your time in the league. So heck, why not take some more crap on them? Then you got, you know, Charles Barkley, and Heather loves to go up on Charles Barkley all the time. So, you know, you got Charles, you know, and then you got Cedric Sabalos. Well, your teams or all of a sudden teams would beat this team. Dude, you didn't do squat your entire career in terms of getting to a damn title game, to a finals. How the hell do you think any of your teams could have beat the Warriors? You know, the first criteria to even being able to say it, your team should have won a title. If your team didn't win a title, then you can shut the fuck up. If you're in the Hall of Fame, yeah, you can get a little bit of run because you think today's league is a little bit softer than it was when you played and you didn't have the three-point line and stuff like that. But let's be real. When the three-point line first came out, players were barely using it. I mean, hell, Larry Bird's one of the greatest three-point shooters to ever play the game, and he barely used it. It was kind of a token thing to him. So, these players that retired, these players that have been champions, these players that are top 50 to ever play the game, these players that are Hall of Famers, just sit back and enjoy the best team in the NBA as currently constructed, the Golden State Warriors. I'm about sick of everybody coming out the woodwork saying their team could have beat this team, especially the ones that didn't even win a ring. I mean, maybe get to the finals, but even then, if you did win a ring, you can shut the hell up. You know, if you're not a Hall of Famer, you can shut the hell up. You know, Hall of Famers, go ahead and have your little moment. I swear, promising, yeah, you wanted to ride us and say you can't. You wonder what you could have done in this kind of league. Yeah, that's great, you know, but you had the moment. You had a triple-double, you were great. You're one of the greatest players ever. No need to throw some shade. No need to throw some shade. There's so much shade being thrown on the Warriors because we were so bad for so long to be so good so quickly. it's so funny to me. You know, you didn't hear about San Antonio. You didn't hear about Houston. You didn't hear about the Lakers teams or the Celtics teams when they made the trade to create the big three. You didn't hear about any of these teams. You didn't hear anybody saying, oh, well, we're going to beat them. Oh, we're going to beat them. Oh, we're going to sweat them. You didn't hear that. So I just find it hysterical that all this is coming to the Warriors. All this, and I'm just going to say, all this hatred. But that's what it is. We don't even get credit where credit's due. You know, so that's been my minute. I probably could have gone on, but I'm getting myself more high on the situation. So people just need to calm the fuck down and shut the hell up. Enjoy the brand of basketball that it is today. The league you helped create, or the league you helped propagate, or whatnot, or perpetuate, or whatever helping the word you want to use. Just enjoy it and stop going shady, because I swear I had never heard it before until my Golden State Warriors won a title, and my Golden State Warriors were fighting to have the best season in the NBA history. Thank you.
What's up, world? This is Double K here from West Coast Bias, otherwise known as K Double from the Raw Impact Unleashed as well. I'm here to tell you about the weekly lineup for Four Aces Presents here on Spreaker.com. Mondays, we have Now versus Then at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. On Tuesdays, we have iRock Radio, 11:30 a.m. On Wednesdays, we have Now versus Then West, coming on at 10 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, about 1 in the morning Eastern. On Fridays, we have Revolving Door episodes, or Revolving Door Fridays, as we call it, as it's Double K's Classroom and Planet Nicole, giving you your weekly doses of entertainment value. Then on Saturdays, we have the Trollgazer Gaming Show, featuring James B. and Randy. You be sure to listen into them, because they'll be sure to make you laugh. And on Sundays, as usual, we have West Coast Bias, featuring the amazing one O'Malley, Mr. Suave himself, and Double K, and every now and then, the one and only coach, The Duel. So be sure to keep listening in to 4H's Presents right here on Spreaker.com. Peace. All right, Suave. Got some words there for the greats. I can feel you. But all right, so let's get into talking some baseball, because that was kind of going to be my primary focus for this episode. But unfortunately, we got sidetracked with some really good topics to open the show, as we normally do. Let's see. All right, so Oakland A's opening day roster looks like this. First, I'll kick it off with the guys that are going to be starting the season on the DL. We got Henderson Alvarez, Raul Alvarez, Sam Fuld, Jared Parker, and Eric Sogard. Sogard, Fuld, and both the Alvarez start the season on a 15-day DL. Jared Parker starts the season on a 60-day DL. So that's a tough one. But you got Chris Davis starting in left field, Billy Burns in center. Right field belongs to Josh Reddick again. Danny Valencia has taken over the third base spot. They let Brett Lowry go. Mark Semien is now working the shortstop. Jed Lowry is back at second base for the A's. And Yadier Alonso will take over at first base, with Stephen Vogt manning behind the plate. Starting lineup as far as pitcher, or Billy Butler, looks to be rotating with Michael Canha as the designated hitter. And you got starting pitching rotation of Sonny Gray, Rich Hill, Kendall Graveman, Felix Dubront, and Chris Bassett. John Axford looks to lead the bullpen, while Sean Doolittle closes it out. Steve, your thoughts on the 2016 Oakland A's squad? What we can look forward to?
What can I look forward to? Well, this team should be able to hit. I mean, I can look forward to that. Got a lot of question marks. The strength of the team over the last 5 years or so is no longer a strength, and that being the bullpen. Still got some big hitters. I like Axford. I like the addition of Benson to the league. I love Doolittle, even though I like him better as a setup relief pitcher. There's still a chance for some pop in this lineup. I mean, even last year, the A's for two-thirds, three-fourths of the season had a positive differential, run differential, yet had a losing record, which if they had been able to continue, that would have been the first time in Major League Baseball history that a team had a positive run differential, yet had a losing record. So I'm actually kind of happy that they weren't able to set that history. Looking at it, offensively, I like this team. Brother, decent hitter, kind of a 300 guy, high volume hits. Not a lot of power in this lineup. You've got Reddick, who can, jack 15, 20 times. Boyd, who kind of came on last year. Simeon, who had a bit of power. Yadier Alonso, who I like a lot. The team can hit. The question will be, they took a huge hit. Draw Parker, they put him, like you said, 60-day disabled, but let's be honest, this season is over. He's going to do another Tom Johnson surgery, trying to resurrect his career, because once you have two, that's kind of the death knell for almost every pitcher that's ever had it. Even though medical technology is unlike it's ever been before, I'm not sold on him being able to come back. I was hoping that this would be the year, but he went and got hurt again. So offensively, I like this team. Defensively, Simeon, still a little bit of a question mark, but they did bring back Washington, who helped make Tejada and Eric Chavez great defenders, and even made Giambi a serviceable defensive first baseman. So I'm hoping for better things this year in terms of defense for Simeon. I like bringing back Jed Lowry. I never thought we should let him go in first place, but we did. But then he has really shown some pop in his bat, and I think he's going to be a good third baseman. Steven Voigt really came up, even though he's really kind of old now, and he's just now kind of hitting the scene of the last, two seasons. If I'm not mistaken, he's already in his 30s. Josh Richards, I'm pretty sure, is going to be the last season at one inning. I'm pretty sure they're going to get something for him, depending on how the season goes. I like Burns in center field. I like Davis in left. Hope a couple of Christian come back at some point. But really, my biggest fear is the pitching. Sonny Gray is the ace. He has been the long all-star representative. I like Hill. He's kind of old, but he's a lefty, which is good. I like Graveman, young prospect type. Blunt, who I really like in Chicago, can come in and redo some things. I like Bassett as well. It's a decent starting five with an ace at the top or a diamond. And then, you've got Ashford, Manson, and Doolittle. Do I think they can challenge? Yes, I think they can challenge. But coming from where they came last year, it's going to take big steps and big strides to the team of even 3 years ago, even though a lot of the same pieces are there. So I think that, honestly, what do I think, the A could be? They're going to challenge early. Then a couple of injuries are going to happen, and the team's going to kind of flounder, shuffle around 500, and then kind of bottom out towards the end of the season because of the, really, if you don't have strength in the pitching staff, you're not really going to get too far. And only A's, and only great pitcher I see is Gray. Everybody else is kind of a question mark. They're hopeful they can be 500 or better out of the starting pitching. So I would like this team to finish third place, second place, is a maybe, if everything clicks and we have injuries. If the other teams in the division really start to pile up the injuries, maybe they could pull off a division title. Maybe. But the percentage of that has got to be, realistically, around 10%, and that's dependent on the three teams in the division having just the scary thrash of injury. But I'm hopeful. I'm not gonna dog them out. I'm remaining hopeful. A couple months into the season, we'll see what the team is about. If they're running around 500, we'll know what's up. But if they're able to go on some sustained winning streaks, win a lot of series, they could contend. Maybe get some. Maybe this could be the beginning of what we had 5 years ago when the team was kind of brought together and everything kind of clicked and we won some division titles. So I'm hopeful, but I'm realistic. I'll put it like that.
Well, I can agree with you. I think this is a 70-75 win team on the realistic in, but up to an 80 to 90 win team if things can go straight. People forget that it's probably only going to be probably till about the middle of this month, maybe early May, before they're going to get Henderson Alvarez back. And Alvarez was a solid pitcher last year last couple of years for the Marlins. So I think he can come in and solidify that lineup. And if they can manage to get Gerard Parker back and up and running like they did before, then this could be a very dangerous team, and they could be hitting their stride come late season, come August, September, you know, or July, August, like, and enough to be able to grab a wild card spot or potentially take the division. So I wouldn't count this team out. I wouldn't necessarily, but I also wouldn't accept my expectations too high for this team, because, like I said, on the more realistic end, they're probably a 70-win team at best, but they also have the capability of being able to be a lot more. So we'll see. We'll have to watch and see what happens. The Giants, on the other hand, are a team that is slated to do fairly well. We're going to kind of gloss over them quickly. It's kind of hoping to wrap it up at an hour point. For those of y'all that know me, I'm a wrestling fan, and today is WrestleMania Day, so I'd like to get to watching my WrestleMania. So we're going to wrap it up quickly with the Giants here and then call it a day. Is that cool with you, Suave?
Absolutely.
All right, so we got a starting pitching lineup with the Giants of Bumgarner, Cueto, Samardzija, Peavy, and Matt Cain, which to me is an all-star worthy lineup in almost any year in the past 4 or 5 years. Sergio Romo anchoring the relief pitching staff with Santiago Casilla as the closer. We got Andre Pagan, Denard Span, Hunter Pence in the outfield, or Angel Pagan, Brandon Crawford, Matt Duffy, Joe Panic, and Brandon Belt manning the infield with Buster Posey, your reliable MVP, behind the plate. So, Suave, your thoughts on the 2016 Giants?
I'm going to say it like this. Sometimes you need luck. And the Giants definitely have some luck. They've grown some talent like Panic and Duffy to come in and kind of solidify the infield. I think Angel Pagan's time as a Giant needs to come to an end after the season. I think Greg Oblako, it's time for him to become a full-time left fielder. Not that he's not the best at that, but, you know, definitely not as injury prone as Pagan. I like the Mark Span, definitely in his range, good defensive center fielder, has a pence, kind of the leader of the team, motivational speaker, as it were. Brandon Crawford stepped into an all-star type role last year. And then he's starting to play well, but supposedly probably, you know, top two best pitcher in the game today. Ben Belt, you're still waiting for him to come out. This might be his last year as a Giant. The Giants actually spent some money in the offseason, even though a lot of people rated their signings as some of the worst. They went out and got Sonny Cueto from Kansas City, who helped them win a title. They brought in against some margin. Was part of the one-shot year for the A's before they messed up everything. They're still hoping that TV can have a good season. They're hoping for a turnaround effort from Matt Cain. They still have Henderson, who I think should have been in rotation this year, but they're going to kind of hold him off and let him be in AAA until they need him. I've always had a soft spot for Sergio Romo, even from his Ono Romo days. Javier Lopez, has got some good skill, definitely a good relief pitcher. Hunter Strickland came in and was just giving up gopher balls almost every time he stepped into the mound, but he seems to calm that down a little bit. Probably a very serviceable relief pitcher. Santiago Casilla, and his fans know him too, is Jaime Cairo. He spent a lot of time that he was uniform under that name before moving to the Giants, which he made that back to his legal name because it turned out he was, you know, 3 years older than he said he was. The Giants have all the pieces. The question is they aren't the only team that made some moves in the division, so can everything come together after they're not making playoffs last year, and every Giants fan would dream of being an even number year and thinking that they're just going to win it all again. It's kind of absurd, but at the same time, that's been the last 6 seasons. So, Bruce Bochy, great manager of this team. You know, it's kind of funny. Talent kind of leads to how good people think you all are. And Bruce Bochy wasn't very well thought of. He was a decent coach with the San Diego Padres for all those years, and nobody thought he was a Hall of Famer. Now he comes to Frisco. They have some good drafts with some good talent. And next thing you know, he's an instant Hall of Famer candidate, but three rings would do that for you. So I think the Giants should challenge for the division, barring injury. I think that people are looking too much into the Dodgers losing Zach Greinke to the Diamondbacks. I think the Diamondbacks are going to be a tough out. They've always had offense, but now they've got an ace pitcher that every four games or is going to come out and really put it down. They went out and made some additional moves. So while the Giants made themselves a bit better by getting Cueto and Samardzija to stick out the starting pitching, the other teams didn't exactly, fall to the wayside as well. So it's going to be a dogfight. It's really a three-team race. I don't feel Colorado is even anymore. Having basically given up last year and traded off their best player in Strelitzky. They still have Carlos Gonzalez, who I think probably will get traded this year or the year after. The Giants' ideal is up until this year, we've been piecemeal. We're going to just enough and hope to get lightning in the bottle. And, last year they were fairly healthy. But at the same time, we weren't even able to get into the postseason. So I'm thinking that they just want to get a shot at the postseason and get it. If they can get in, they have the confidence. When every time they've been in the last couple of years, they've won the title. So I think that's their goal. Regardless of whether it's division or wild card, I like Bumgarner. He's one of the best pitchers in baseball. Cueto, he has some good moments, but at the same time, I'm not 100% sold to be exactly blow the doors off of Kansas City up until the playoffs. Samardzija, same kind of role. He was flat out pretty bad for Chicago White Sox last year. But then people wanted to say, they had terrible defense. Yeah, but he was still giving up those hits that they couldn't field. So it's not like, it just falls, their defense is the reason he had a bad year last year. No, Samardzija's got some good stuff, but it's not always on point. It's not an ace. Serviceable, been around a while. You got Matt King trying to come back from injury, bone spurs, and all this other stuff, and trying to reclaim what he was before he becomes the next ex-giant, like Tim Lincecum of the great years. So I'm not 100% sold that they're strong enough. I am appreciative that they finally went out and spent some big money, but I am also a little worried that they gave Cueto a 2-year out on a 6-year deal, which was kind of strange. So he can re-up, basically, in two more seasons. So that doesn't exactly bode well, especially considering in another 2 years or so, you're going to have to re-up Bumgarner. And Bumgarner, let's be honest, I mean, that's one thing. You don't really have to worry about salaries in baseball to an extent, but Bumgarner is going to be a damn near 10-year, $300 million guy. He's going to get damn near $30 million a year. So you can basically bank that. And while Matt Cain's deal will probably come off the board by then, there's some plan on that because I believe Matt Cain's making like $22 million. At some point you're going to have to pay for these people or repay in Cueto's case if he's up to stuff and that's a good season for you. And you can beat out the other free agent, bidders. So I like the youth on this team. I think the Giants have a good chance of being the top team in their division, but I'm not going to look past Arizona. I'm not just because, they finished their last handful of years or second the last handful of years, never won the division really. Outside of the year, they won it all back in the day with Randy Johnson and Gonzalez. So, I'm not going to look past the teams in their division. LA is still a good team. They still have Kershaw. They still got some youngsters. They still got some pop in the lineup. Arizona, pop in the lineup. They just brought in Greinke. They've made some new moves to kind of solidify their starting pitching and elite pitching. So, really, this division is up for grabs. And the only real bright spot going for the Giants is this stigma that every even year they're going to get to the playoffs to win it all. So while I'm hopeful as an A's fan that they can get to the playoffs and get beaten so we can get rid of this stupid stigma that every Giants fan thinks that it's an even year, this is the year they're going to do it all again, So while the A's fan in me says that, the Bay fan in me says that this team does have a chance, realistically, to win a title this year if they can stay healthy, even if they would just be a wild card. So, as an A's fan, I can't hate. As a Bay fan, I got to give my love. So they actually went out and spent some money. I thought they could have done better. I would have much rather seen, Greinke as well as Quay on some margins. But at least the Giants spent some money versus spending no money, you know. So kind of how I feel about the Giants.
All right, Suave was a, I'm sorry, I didn't catch the last part of what you said there. Sorry.
I think the Giants could, you know, win it all, but it's going to, you know, come down and have a couple of results, and Dodgers are going to be in a dogfight all the season.
Well, I agree 100% that, yeah, that's the truth, that it will depend on the rest of the division. Whether or not the Giants end up being able to even get to the postseason this year. But, you know, they do have that luck of the even year, but we'll see. We'll see. All right, guys, yeah, I sound like I'm in a rush because I kind of am. We're going to go on ahead and close it on up now. We'll be back again next week at 3. We'll be discussing a little bit more about Giants, not just Giants, but Dodgers, Padres, just baseball season in general as baseball kicks off today. So happy baseball day, happy WrestleMania day for those fans, and hopefully happy get rid of Colin Kaepernick day for 49ers fans. We'll see. All right, guys. All right, Stav. Any last words?
Yeah, teams that won a title and players that are great don't need to associate on new teams that are great.
There you go. As said very well by the man, Mr. Suave. All right, y'all. We'll see y'all next week. Till then, stay up, stay out, and do your thing. This has been West Coast Bias. Peace.